How are you guys doing? So that was kind of silly, right? Emotions, Mariah Carey. Who doesn't love Mariah? Sometimes we have to do something silly to get people's attention because people overdo the live videos sometimes. So just wanted to put that on there just to get your attention. It is a little silly, but we're talking about something kind of serious. We're talking about emotions and essential oils. So welcome. My name is Amanda Lehman. I am a certified personal trainer and fitness nutrition specialist in Southeast Texas. I am a member of the awesome group, The Wellness Project. So we want to talk about our emotions as they pertain to using essential oils. So some of you are probably wondering how essential oils can affect our emotions and support our moods. Basically, we're talking about supporting the body's limbic system. I'm a science geek, so I'm going to touch on that a little bit. I'm just going to give you like a little overview. I'm not going to go too deep into it. I'm going to try to respect your time and be quick. So I'm going to be reading from my notes here to stay on track because I get distracted. I connect to everything and I will go off in left field and talk about all kinds of stuff and we don't have time for that. So I'm going to be using my notes and reading, so just forgive that. So I'm going to touch just a little bit on the limbic system and basically how essential oils affect that system of the body and can affect our emotions and our memory and our mood. I'm also going to be sharing later in the day a little bit about, in detail, my friend Tracy Moore has done some webinars on emotions and essential oils. Hi, Danielle. And she is doing a webinar right now. And I'm going to post the link in the comments of this video to that webinar so you can go back and look more in depth. Tracy has actually gone over each individual oil in the starter kit, which I'm going to post a link on another post later to that video. It's about 30 minutes long, but she goes into detail on how each oil in the starter kit can have an emotional application as well. So just a little bit of information there, but let's go ahead and dig into this a little bit. So we live in this society of emotional turmoil, right? More and more evidence is accumulating that our emotional health can have a profound effect on our physical health as well. And we all know that in this group. We understand that. We know stress can kill. We know that. Many doctors are recognizing the possibility that a number of diseases are actually caused by emotional problems that link back to childhood and infancy, even as far back as the womb for some people. These emotional problems can compromise body systems and even genetic structuring through a process that creates the equivalent of molecular memory in our cells, in key organs of our body and structures. The idea that memories and trauma can be embedded in the brain is not new, but science is finally catching up to what we intuitively already know. Now saying that these brain imprints can extend throughout the body and manifest themselves physically. So how do essential oils work in regards to our memories and emotions? For the purpose of discussing our emotions today, we're going to focus on the limbic system. That's going to include specific collection of structures deep in the brain. I'm going to show you a graphic in just a second that illustrates these structures while I explain what they do. And we're going to talk a little bit about those structures. So look around. And here is our picture. And I love this. It's beautiful. I love the brain. I love this picture. Really quick, I connect everything to creation, okay? I look at the human body, even our cells, every organ, every structure, but specifically look at the brain, right? Just look at that. God created that. And if we look at our sense of smell, you have your olfactory bulbs, which sit right here at the bridge of your nose, right above the eye. And if you look at this little pathway, right? Here's your olfactory bulb. Look how it wraps around the deepest part of your brain, right? And all of these little structures and pathways do different things and communicate in different ways and have different effects. But if you're just looking at that picture and you see your sense of smell and you think about creation and that God created everything with a purpose, that is a beautiful thing, especially to those of us who have tons of testimonies with our essential oils and love our oils and use them daily. A lot of people are like, oh, aromatherapy, she's a hippie, she likes sniffing patchouli. No, guys, look at that. Look at creation of your sense of smell. Just that one little detail in your brain. When you smell something, and to me, this is beautiful because it looks like a little megaphone at the top, you know, and that's not technically what it is, but just for the purposes of looking at the design of the brain, all of these important structures, your sense of smell wraps around those important structures in the brain. And to me, that's amazing. So I could talk all day about that little picture, but I won't do that to you. So the limbic system is comprised of all of these structures, okay? You have the thalamus, which is this big red blob right in the middle of your brain. And it is responsible for detecting and relaying information from all five of your senses. So all five of your senses go to the thalamus, okay? And that little structure is responsible for detecting, hey, someone just touched me. That's cold. That hurts. You know, whatever. Look what I can see. Look what I can smell. Look what I can touch. Look what I can feel. That's the structure that detects all of your information from your five senses. Then you have your hypothalamus, okay? Your hypothalamus is in front, right here. There's a little area right here in front of the thalamus. It's responsible for producing multiple hormones, which control water levels in the body, deep sleep cycles, body temperature, and food intake. So basically, it's very important. We're talking about survival stuff here. The amygdala. Amygdala is here. You have two of those. The amygdala are little almond-shaped structures, you know, left and right beside each other. Two little almond-shaped clusters of nerve cells, both responsible for preparing the body for emergency situations and for storing memories of events for future recognition, okay? They also assist in the development of memories associated with fear and panic, and they play an additional role in pleasure and sexual arousal. That's your amygdala, right there. Your pituitary gland. This little guy right here is a beast. That little thing right there is the master gland. That's what we call that, okay? Your pituitary, this gland is referred to as the master gland because it controls several of the other hormone-producing glands. It's the boss. It's your hormone boss. That little thing right there. Right there, okay? So, he's the boss. Your pituitary is responsible for producing growth hormone. That's a huge one. Not just in childhood, throughout life, too. It's a big one. Responsible for producing growth hormone. Puberty hormones, the hormones that initiate cortisol production or your stress hormone, your fight or flight hormone, and the antidiuretic hormone. Pituitary is responsible for all that. That little guy right there. Okay. Here's where we talked about I'm going to be reading from my notes a little bit to stay on track because clearly I get distracted. So I'm going to read a little bit to you. Because the limbic system is directly connected to those parts of your brain that control heart rate, blood pressure, breathing, memory, stress levels, and hormone balance, essential oils can have profound physiological and psychological effects. The sense of smell is the only one of your five senses that is directly linked to the limbic lobe of the brain. The only one. Your other senses are not directly linked to your limbic lobe. Only your sense of smell. Only your sense of smell. The emotional control center. So all of your emotions, what we're talking about today, your emotions, they all come from that region of the brain. Your sense of smell is the only one connected directly to that. The other ones can have an effect and they play a role in the limbic system of the brain, but the only one directly connected, touching, linked into it is your sense of smell. That's huge. So the emotions of anxiety, depression, fear, anger, and joy all emanate from this region of your brain, that deep section we just talked about with all those structures. So that's the actual anatomy. So let's put it into practice with a little bit of physiology, and that's going to require a little bit of chemistry. So don't freak out on me. I'm not going to give you a college chemistry class. Chemistry was one of my lowest sciences anyway, so we won't dig into it too deep. Super simplified, so don't freak out. But just follow me here for a second. Because of the tiny molecular structure of the components of an essential oil, tiny, tiny structure of the molecules in essential oil. They are extremely concentrated. So those 5 mil and 15 milliliter bottles that have, 85, 250 drops in them, each drop of oil is highly concentrated because the molecules are so, so, so teeny tiny. Because they are so small, they are extremely concentrated. One drop of essential oil contains approximately, depending on the oil, 40 million trillion molecules. One drop of oil, 40 million trillion molecules. Numerically, that's a 4 with 19 zeros after it. That's a big number. We have 100 trillion cells in our body. Your body, you have 100 trillion cells. One drop of essential oil, one drop, contains enough molecules to cover every single cell in your body with 40,000 molecules. So if you have not heard those numbers before, that's insane. 40,000 molecules in one drop of essential oil for every cell in your body. Considering that it only takes one molecule of the right kind to open a receptor site on your cell and communicate with your DNA to alter cellular function, considering that it only takes one molecule of the right kind to do those things, you can see why even inhaling a small amount of oil vapor can have profound effects on the body, the mind, the emotions, your mood, hormone balance, those things. So sometimes too many oil molecules overload the receptor site and they freeze up, right? I've had this experience with my son with different eucalyptus blends, eucalyptus oils with the chemical 1,8-cineol. I've experienced acute toxicity with that. So that's a real thing. It's science. It's chemistry. Sometimes too many oil molecules overload the receptor sites and they freeze up without responding at all or by having some sort of neuromuscular or neurological reaction. When a smaller amount would have been just right. So it's possible to use too much, obviously. This is why we say that when using oils, sometimes less is more, less is better. But sometimes more is better too. Knowing the difference in that art is called the art of aromatherapy. Essential oils are mixtures of dozens, even hundreds of chemical constituents, all of which are composed of carbon and hydrogen and sometimes oxygen. All essential oils are principally composed of a class of organic compounds built of isoprene units. And the only reason why I'm doing this stair step is just to show you I have a lot of green in my personality. I need to understand why and how something works. I didn't just say, oh, they're pretty and they smell good, sign me up. No, I need to know why do these work, how do they work. So some of you need that. Okay, we have a ton of leaders in this group that have different strengths and different passions, like to teach in different ways. So my thing is I got to know how and why something works. So I'm doing this little stair step for you. Even if you don't care about isoprene units, you need to understand that we're building something here, okay? So all of your essential oils are composed of organic compounds that are built. You have a lot of green too. Oh, hi, Jenny. That's cool. Built of isoprene units. An isoprene unit is a set of 5 connected carbon atoms with 8 hydrogens attached. I'm not going to dig into this deep. Don't quit on me. Their molecular weight is only 68 AMU, which is very, very, very small. Molecules built of isoprene units are all classified as terpenes. That's where I'm going with this. Terpenes. That's the word you want. I broke it down smaller than terpenes, but terpenes is where we're camping out, okay? Terpenes are what make essential oils unique in the world of natural substances, okay? So we're talking different than herbs, different than supplements, different than food and water. Essential oils are completely unique because of terpenes. So there's some different types of terpenes. Phenylpropanoids, that's one type. Phenylpropanoids are compounds of carbon ring molecules incorporating one isoprene unit. That's your chemistry. There are dozens of varieties of phenylpropanoids. Phenylpropanoids are found in these oils in this percentage. Now, there are more oils that contain phenylpropanoids, but I'm just going to give you some examples. Clove is 90% phenylpropanoid. Cassia, 80%. Basil, 75%. Oregano, 60%. Peppermint has, and I'm going to use peppermint again in a second. Peppermint has 25% phenylpropanoids, okay? So made up of 25% phenylpropanoids. While they can create conditions where unfriendly viruses and bacteria cannot live, the most important function performed by phenylpropanoids is that they clean the receptor sites on your cells. Phenylpropanoids can clean receptor sites. So you've got some synthetic fragrance molecule junking up some places where some estrogen belongs on your cells. Phenylpropanoids and essential oils can clean those receptor sites out, okay? Without clean receptor sites, cells cannot communicate. There's things junking up the sites where something else is supposed to be. So when we clean those out, then the body can communicate between the cells. So when they can't communicate, the body malfunctions, resulting in sickness, symptom, disease, etc. Okay, so that's your phenylpropanoids. They clean the receptor sites. Good to know. Sesquiterpenes. This is my favorite. Sesquiterpenes are my favorite. The oils high in sesquiterpenes give me major, major reaction. Emotionally, okay? And I'm going to talk about that later today, too. I typed up my personal testimony. I couldn't do it in a video. I would cry. Nobody wants to see me cry. Okay, sesquiterpenes. There are more than 10,000 kinds of sesquiterpenes. Sesquiterpenes are the principal constituents of cedarwood, That's what we're giving away today. Cedarwood is 98% sesquiterpenes, okay? Vetiver is 97%, another good oil. Spikenard is 93%. Sandalwood is 90%. Love sandalwood. Patchouli is 71%. Myrrh is 62%. So-and-so, et cetera. Sesquiterpenes deliver oxygen molecules to cells. That's a big deal, okay? That's a really big deal. We have things, we have toxins in our body that are handicapping our body from communicating between cells and getting oxygen and carrying out their functions, okay? So we look to all of these issues and these symptoms. Guys, we don't need to talk about symptoms and sickness and disease and conditions. We don't need to talk about that. We need to talk about what's going on in our body that's keeping our body from doing what it was designed to do by God, period, okay? Sesquiterpenes deliver oxygen. They help deliver oxygen, just like hemoglobin does in the blood. So in your blood, your hemoglobin carries your... I get distracted by comments. I know, Keisha, I love sandalwood. It's so amazing. I'm jealous right now. I need some. Hemoglobin delivers oxygen in your blood, okay? Sesquiterpenes are capable of delivering oxygen molecules to your cells in your body. They can also erase or deprogram miswritten codes in the DNA. That's big, okay? That's big. So that's your sesquiterpenes. Monoterpenes is another class of terpenes. There are an estimated 2,000 varieties of monoterpenes. They are found in most essential oils. Most essential oils contain monoterpenes. Galbanum is 80% monoterpene. Angelica, 73%. Peppermint, again. Here we go with peppermint. 45% monoterpenes, right? So peppermint is 45% monoterpenes. Up here, peppermint was also 25% phenylpropanoid, okay? So you have all of these different terpenes going on. Some oils have one of the terpen, some have two, some have all three, okay? That's big. I'm gonna talk about that in just a second, and I'm getting close, guys. I know I'm going a little bit long. I'm really sorry. Okay, so while offering a variety of properties, the most important ability of monoterpenes is that they can reprogram miswritten information in the cellular memory. You got that, right? Your DNA, cellular memory, miswritten information. How many of us have lifelong issues of having something spoken over us or something that we've done or someone has done to us? How many of us deal with that on a daily basis? Okay, I'm gonna raise my hand. That's everybody, okay? Everybody has that. We have something in essential oils that is capable of cleaning receptor sites where things are not supposed to be, where something else is supposed to be carrying out its function, but it can't get to it. We have something in essential oils that is capable of rewriting, deprogramming, and then rewriting miswritten information in your cells, okay? That's huge. That's amazing. So we have a triple whammy with some oils, right? The effect of using oils that contain all three classes of terpenes, your phenylpropanoids, your sesquiterpenes, and your monoterpenes, or a collection of oils. You can use multiple oils, or you can use a blend, right? And you don't have to understand the science. That's the beautiful part of this. I love it. I love trying to figure it out and learn as much as possible about the science behind it and the why and the how. But if you don't care about that, if you just like how sandalwood smells and you want to use it and you like how it makes you feel, do it. Praise God, use it. You know what I'm saying? You don't have to understand the science. It's there if you want it. It's there and it's real, created by God. And we will never even a fraction wrap our mind around what He has created. That's why you can't create lavender in a lab. Not the way God makes it. You can't get lavender from the grocery store and get what God put in a lavender plant. You can't do it. It's not going to happen. Not to mention we have lavender from all over the world. We have lavender in Utah. We have lavender from France. It's different. The soil's different. The conditions are different. You're never going to recreate that in a lab ever. And Young Living understands that. Gary Young created this company and creates his blends and his oils with integrity. And he understands what God has created and does not taint it. So that's amazing, guys. I really got off on that. I'm sorry I do that. Stick to the notes. My friend tells me stick to the notes. Okay. So we have oils with a triple whammy. They have all three classes of terpenes. Or you can use a blend. So it's very powerful in addressing many cellular functions in the body. That is because using all three accomplishes the following. So we broke it down. So just to bring it all back together, we have oils that can accomplish all three of these things at once. First, the phenylpropanoid-containing oils clean the receptor site, allowing for the proper transfer of hormones, peptides, neurotransmitters, steroids, other intracellular messengers, okay? So we clean those sites. Second, the oils that contain sesquiterpenes deprogram or erase the wrong information from cellular memory stored in the DNA. And I told you guys already, we're giving away cedarwood. Cedarwood is 98% sesquiterpenes. That one is a powerful one for me. I'm going to share my testimony later with it. But it's big. It's a big one. Erases, deprograms wrong information. Third, your monoterpenes reprogram the cells with the correct information, okay? These three classes of chemical components are why essential oils can sometimes create an effect that is nearly instant for some people. And my cedarwood testimony, instant. Instant, guys. And when you read it, it's a little bit, you know, it's a few paragraphs long. It's a little testimony, but like I said, you don't want me to say it on a video. I'll be crying. You'll be crying on your lunch break, crying at your desk. We don't want to do that. Just read it. It's really cool. It was instant for me. I have very few instant reactions with essential oils. I love the way they smell. I take them in, but our personalities are all different. You know, sometimes we don't even realize we're having a reaction sometimes. This was Jesus like slapping me upside the face when I smelled cedarwood for the first time. Amazing. So we have oils that can create all three of these effects at the same time. And this can be nearly instant and also permanent. My reaction happened 2 years ago with cedarwood. I'm a different person from that, okay? What I want to tell you, let's see, while a specific oil may have one or two of these three classes of compounds as its predominant chemistry, just like we said, peppermint has 45% of this and 25% of this. So the oils have different combinations and percentages of the different compounds. All 12 of the biblical oils contain some percentage of all three. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that fascinating and amazing and beautiful that the 12 biblical oils contain all three of the classes of terpenes? That God created plants that when we use the plants as He intended for us to use them, and we don't add anything to them or take anything away from them, with integrity and with intention use them, and some of us with prayer, that they are able to go into our cells, your trillions of cells, each one individually, clean sites, deprogram wrong information, and program with correct information. That's awesome. That's awesome to me. All 12 of the biblical oils. If you don't know about the biblical oils yet, there are 12 of them. There's a whole kit, the 12 ancient oils, the 12 oils of ancient scripture kit. People do classes on the 12 biblical oils all of the time. You can get that in a kit. Those 12 oils are sandalwood, cassia, cedarwood, cypress, frankincense, galbanum, hyssop, myrrh, myrtle, onycha, rose of Sharon, and spikenard. And spikenard was the oil that, it is amazing, Tracy, it is amazing. Spikenard is the oil that Mary of Bethany anointed Jesus' feet with. And after I began using essential oils, when you read biblical stories now, just when you get to the oil references, oh my gosh, right? It has a whole different meaning, you know? So that is the oil that Jesus' feet was anointed with according to scripture. So my personal experiences with cedarwood. So we're supposed to share a personal experience revolving around our topic of the day, and mine is with cedarwood. So that's going to be next, maybe, or after that, the personal experience. I'm not sure. We'll see. Be watching for the notifications, guys. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more in detail. If you have an emotional testimony, you're welcome to share it in our group. It's a safe place to share. If you have questions or need help, if you got your oils to address something totally different and had no clue that you could address emotions with your oils, dig into it a little bit, because we all deal with emotions. We all have emotions all day long, every day. Rubbing oils on it doesn't magically make your emotions go away, but it helps pull out some negative things and replace the negative with positive. And that's what we want to do. We want our emotions to be good emotions. Jesus had righteous anger. Anger is a healthy thing sometimes. Stress can be a healthy thing. It can get you out of bad situations. Stress helps you remember certain things. Don't touch that. It's hot. Just because an emotion has a negative connotation doesn't mean it's evil. God gave us all of our emotions. They have a purpose, just like all the oils, just like everything in your body has a purpose. But prolonged experience of a certain emotion can cause physiological and real, very real physical problems. And we know that, guys. There are people that deal with it all day long, every day. So just be aware that you can balance and address your emotions with essential oils and try it. Use them. I hope you guys found this a little video that's 28 minutes long now. Oh my gosh, Anna's gonna kill me. It's supposed to be 15 minutes long, even following my notes. But I'm gonna post the link to Tracy Moore's emotional webinar that's going on right now. It's happening right now. I think it's a part two, right, Tracy? Correct me if I'm wrong. But she does this a lot. Tracy Moore is in Florida, and she is a licensed mental health professional. I'm just a geek about anatomy and physiology. That's it. I love it. I study it. I share it. I do science experiments on myself all the time. Don't tell anybody. I'm just a science geek. Tracy is a licensed mental health professional. She's doing webinars on emotions and essential oils. She breaks down the entire starter kit with emotional applications of each one of the oils that you already have. And she also goes outside the starter kit and talks about different oils. So there's so much more to this than what I've given you guys today. I just gave you a little bit of my heart. I gave you what I'm obsessed with, which is the geek stuff. Let us know if you have any questions. You can tag Tracy Moore. Tracy's commenting a lot on this video. You can ask me. You can ask Anna, your leader. There's thousands of people in this group. We're all a big, happy, young, living family. So balance your emotions, use your essential oils, and I hope you guys are having an amazing day. I had a question I'm supposed to ask on my video, and I have notes all over the place. I'm going to post it. I'm going to edit this, and I'm going to post my question underneath the subject line. So be watching for that to interact on the post. And you guys have a great rest of your day, and be watching for the rest of the emotional post today. Thanks for joining me. Bye.